Hi, Joey here. I wanted to touch upon one of my favourite subjects, which I mentioned in my blurb on the channel, and that is coming back to guitar playing after a long layoff. In my case, it was exactly 18 years to the very month. Reflecting on how hard it is to come back to playing when you've had such a big break. It is very, very hard. The longer the break, the harder it seems to become. And you'll use any excuse not to do it. Even though you tell yourself you want to do it, you don't do it. So that's sort of my experience. And I've met many people across YouTube where they've had a similar experience. So, it's something fairly universal for people who've taken a long break. In my case, I was very fortunate, noting I'd already been retired a few years, so I actually had zero excuse for not doing it. I kept telling myself I was going to do it, but didn't. And then a few things happened all of a sudden in the space of about 3 or 4 weeks, which sort of gave me the push along. I saw advertised in the local community centre an acoustic guitar group, so I applied to join it, and so that was the first thing. And then coincidentally, I knew a bloke who worked with me at Parliament House here in Canberra, who lived around the corner. Not only did he play, he was a member of the group, which I didn't realise. So that was fortuitous. So he helped me prepare for coming in to the acoustic guitar group, and so we did a few sessions on our own before I joined up, and sort of kept that going for a while actually. So that helped a lot. That gave me extra motivation, and then finally, a bit after that, there was a school reunion where I was invited to join up with some old schoolmates and play at the school reunion as a band. So that gave me a lot of motivation to get going. So all that's happening, yeah, as I say, in the space of 3 or 4 weeks, all that happened. So that was all good. But things also happened that could have put me off course. For example, so it's an acoustic guitar group, so my intention is to play my Fender acoustic hanging up on the wall here. And of course, when I get it out where it's been lying for however many years, and my fingers are that soft, I could not could not play anything on it without, hurting my fingers. Yes, I'm a wimp, but it was quite noticeable that my fingers were nowhere near in a position to play the steel string. The electric theoretically would have been better because it's a lighter gauge, etc. But then I got my amp out of, a corner in the garage there would have been sitting forever. And of course, it didn't work anymore. So, plus you can imagine what the strings on both those guitars were like. Pretty ordinary. So that was a bit of a barrier straight away. And under normal circumstances, that may have sort of waylaid me and may have stopped me from coming back. But I did have this, which is my nylon string. And of course, nylon strings last forever. And so I got it out. But of course, okay, that's good. I mean, the nylon strings are gentler on your fingers, so that was a big help those first few weeks. I'm getting back into it, yeah, trying to get my fingers ready, prepared for ultimately playing the steel string. But what am I going to play on my nylon string when I literally cannot remember a thing, cannot remember anything? Now, as it happens, I had this book lying around. I had purchased it maybe a couple of years earlier, just on a whim, secondhand, just saw it. I might have been just, like I've talked recently, just going through a secondhand bookshop and found it and bought it on a whim, never, maybe never looked at it. So it was lying around, and I had a bit of a look at it, and this book. I mean, I've seen it around before and since. So it's been around for years in publication, I mean, and still sells. I've seen it in our local guitar shop, so they still publish it. This one, this version must be very old because it advertises cassettes on the back. So I'm guessing this one's about 30 years old. So the author is a guy called Russ Shipton, and he clearly had a bunch of beginners guitar books. Then there's a series of four, and this appears to complement those books for beginners that go up to four, as I say. And in this booklet, you can sort of sense that the songs go from fairly simple to a bit more involved as you go through the book. But anyway, the thing I liked about the book is it's nicely laid out, just the songs, and it's just basic chords and melody, and pretty much nothing else for the most part. And so what I liked about that is, even with the simpler arrangements, is the scope it gave you for doing your own arrangements of the songs. And so that's what I started doing straight away. In fact, the first song is a song you'll all know, Amazing Grace. And I worked on it, and look, let me give you an idea. So if you can imagine, it's been 18 years since I've played. I've got my nylon string, I don't know what to play. I've got this book, first song's Amazing Grace. And this is exactly how I went about it. This is my personal experience. Everyone's is different, of course. But the outcome, I would say, was pretty good in the end. So if you look up on the screen, I've done a guitar pro of, and this book doesn't have tabs, it's all music. So that was another thing I'm having to remember how to read music again, yeah? So that was one of the benefits for me. But I've done it as a guitar pro, and so as a tab, and basically that's info in the book. Just, you see the key, the chords, in the key of A, so it's just A, D, and E, yeah, the chords, nothing special. And then you see the basic melody, yeah? So I'll just play up to that. That's just the melody. Now, what I would have toy around with at the time, let me put up the next one. What if we just add the bass note at the start of each bar? So now we've sort of got a minimum two notes playing at a time. So you end up with something like this. Because it's such a big break. Now I've just added that extra bit at the end because it also gives you an idea that we can develop this. So we're going from just having a melody and chords to creating your own arrangement. So this is what I'm getting at. This is what I jumped into straight away, right? Haven't played, got a simple song, simple arrangement, and see how there's what I did at the end there. Oh, another thing, so when we just look at the melody, which is fine to practice as well, just practicing to read music, when we get to that triplet, you know. So could I remember how to do triplets? I mean, I probably could. I can't remember exactly what my action was. But the point is, when you're looking at a well-known song, da-da-da-da, you work, oh, a triplet, yeah, da-da-da. you work out your triplet, yeah? So that's one of the advantages of looking at a well-known song like this. You know the melody. You may not have heard this song for years, but you're always going to know the melody. It's going to help you read the music. It's going to help you work out a triplet, which at that point you might find tricky. Also, you notice every bar starts with a semi note, or is that what it's called? Whole note, semi note, a two beat note. Therefore, early on, I worked out, okay, so I've got lots of space to add extra notes from the chord to fill in the space. So that's we're developing our arrangement. You see, in fact, if you take a close look at the book, you'll see at points I've handwritten an extra note in between after the semi note, where I've, so in this case, it's A. So on that second beat, I just add in that open A, yeah. Add in that E again. Where are we? Add in the F sharp. Add in the E again. Plenty of space to just add in a little run on the E then. What's next? Now I'm adding that E bass because I'm that high E is now part of the melody, yeah? So. F sharp again. Now the G. Sorry, it's an E, but a C sharp. And with that final bit, so when you do that triplet, you always end up on the C sharp, but the C sharp of an A. At the end, where you get into the climax of the song, you end up playing a C sharp with the E. And that might be a good opportunity to throw in another note from the E chord. So we might do some like... So anyway, so I went through the songs in this book just doing this sort of thing with my nylon string, right? Preparing my fingers, getting my fingers to work together, and getting back into music, getting my head back into music. I mean, that's a critical thing. Just start exploring the guitar, start getting used to doing stuff. Doing your own arrangements, just getting your head back into music. This is what it did for me. And then finally, my fingers are ready to, and I've changed my strings to play the steel string, got my amp repaired, so I'm playing the electric, and the nylon string ended up doing its job. Anyway, that's my story. The moral there is not that you need to be doing all this, but... do something that helps you back in. I mean, that's a critical point. Do something that gets you back into it. And it actually doesn't matter what it is. That really is the moral of the story. Just get back into it. Okay, thanks for listening. Bye-bye.